Welcome you all. My name is Oli Khadevi. So ladies and gentlemen, we ran a short story competition for the giving the learners at the high schools an opportunity to showcase their skill in writing short stories. So we have two categories, the English category and isiZulu category as well. And then the adjudicators for the English was Mitchell Harper from the Center for Creative Arts and Taryn Lee King. And for isiZulu, it was Hlengiwe Dladla and myself, Oli Khadebe. So firstly, I'd like to call uBabu Zakes Mda to join me on stage as I'm about to give my VIPs what they deserve. So sizoqala nge English category winners. Taking the third place, it was Luthando Ngayana representing Port Shepstone High School with the short story titled An Abandoned House. Luthando, please join us on stage. Thank you. And the second place, Ulwandle Mzimela, representing Hillcrest High School with the short story titled When a Goddess Loves a Mortal. Luthando, please join us on stage. Jatu Koto used to say, Odle umhlanganiso, obaqwaqwade wonke makhanda. It will be, I'm not too sure whether I'll be pronouncing it right, Kriti Lala, representing Westville Girls High, with the short story titled The King of District 64. Okay, sesiya esigabeni sethu sesiZulu. Unamba othathe iposition yesithathu. Umlondi Ndlovu, representing Sterlitsa Secondary School for Akusasizi. Unombolo 2, Thandeka Khanyile, representing Zef Domo High School. Icala limbula ingubo lingene. And then number one, representing East Court High School, with the short story titled Zangifanela Izinyosi. It's Lindelwa Khumalo. Well, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to call Ukatla Hotawunyane on stage as the... No, I still need you to take a group. Oh, okay. As the Literature Festival Coordinator to join them and take a picture with them. Thank you so much. Our first panel for tonight, they'll be speaking on the topic of the language of the heart and soul. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to welcome on stage Ubabu Nakanjani Sibiya, ehambisana no Sabata-Mpho Mokae, facilitated by Russel, Russel Hlongwane. A big round of applause for them as they take the stage.
Sanborn. Yes, good, good, good. Gents. Zinsezu. Corner. Good evening, everyone. As my sister had said, my name is Russel Hlongwane, and I will be journeying with these two gentlemen, these two giants, for the next 40 minutes. I hope this will be stimulating for you, as it will be for me. We started this journey on Monday, so we started teasing the subject a bit at an audience out in Mpumalanga. It was an audience of school students. It'll be interesting for me to take this discussion slightly deeper, yet still responding or talking to some of the central points to the theme. So I'd rather let you gentlemen introduce yourselves, please. It was Galuta.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nakanjani G. Sibiya. I come from the north coast of this province, and I write in isiZulu, mainly short stories, but cross genres. My writings are a disappointment, particularly for those who unlucky enough to know me in person, and when they read my books, they realize that my books are, or my writings are, devoid of any humor, as they observe in their interaction with me. But once they read my books, they realize that I'm not as humorous as in my writings. I don't come across as humorous. I write about serious stuff, issues that pertain to our everyday encounter and our everyday activities, issues that our societies are battling with, issues that are close to our hearts. In my writings, I try to portray that life is not as humorous as most of us believe. Life is not supposed to be taken for granted. There are issues that we can't wish our way, but we have to offer some solutions, such as shins, and come to terms with them. And do I still have to say more? But basically, okubalulekile bengifuna ukusho ukuthi ngiyombhali ngibhala ngesiZulu ngisola sengathi ngibhala kahle ngoba nakho ngiminyiwe nanamuhla endaweni
kahle kahle
siyabonga
bengikudabukela yikho kumemile
no sengiqadile I'm done. I've done a brief introduction. But then our facilitator suggested that I read from my writings, but then I didn't want to bore you with my writing, and I know that there isn't enough time, so the best option would be to read my books instead. I don't want to waste your time by reading from my text, unfortunately. Yes.
Good evening, friends. My name is Sabata-Mpho, Mokae. I write in English and Setswana, but mainly in Setswana. Though I write across genres, I write mainly fiction. My fiction is in Setswana. My stories, my Setswana fiction is largely post-apartheid South African issues. Yeah, that's what I write.
Thank you. As a starting point, I would like to know from you, gentlemen, what does it mean to write with the language of the soul and heart? If you could just frame that for us, how is it interpreted personally?
I mean, for me, the language of the heart and soul, to write in it, firstly, as a black South African, I've got the advantage of not being English speaking. You know, I English was introduced later to me. So I was the language that introduced the world and everything to me is Setswana, and English just came later. So that's a massive advantage because this language introduced a worldview to me, introduced concepts, a lot of things to me. So I'm able to view the world through both lenses,
right.
You see. And when I started writing in Setswana, I'd been writing in English. See, I made a decision at some point that I'm now going to write in this language, in the language that I know better. Mm. And that moment for me, it was a taste of freedom, you know. For the first time, I knew how it feels like to write in first language, right? And not write in translation. In fact, before I started writing in Setswana, I had not been aware that writing in English was writing in translation. Because, I mean, come on, I grew up in a village where everybody speaks Setswana. Even now, I live in a city where petrol attendants, cashiers, everybody speaks Setswana until I get to work, where less than half of my colleagues speak English, less than half, right? Because, I mean, even at the university, less than half of the people are academics. Many, many people are not. So this language is so much around me. The stories that I'm writing, they come from Haleshewe, they come from Deep Kloof, they come from Mafike, and they come from Potchefstroom. They come from this community that I know better. Right? So a character in my story that says, Orarraho. I have to translate that into English if I, you see.
Yeah.
Now, in my Setswana stories, these swear words and all these things, they come in Setswana. It's no longer in translation. There's no burden in me anymore to translate. It was a taste of freedom. Gotcha. Hence I said the other day that it was like losing virginity. You don't go back. You see, it tasted something. You want it again.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know.
For me, writing in isiZulu comes naturally because I'm Mezulu. I was born and grew up surrounded by isiZulu. Everything about me has always been isiZulu. isiZulu has played a central role in my life. So I would say it comes naturally. Well, unlike my colleague here, I've never written anything in English, except for the compositions that we were expected to write in high schools or in primary school, and I didn't get high marks in that. Maybe my teachers were jealous or something, or they could not realize the potential in me. But jokes aside, writing in isiZulu comes naturally. I've never done a comparative analysis as to whether I write better in English or I write better in isiZulu. isiZulu chose me. But then, in as much as I think had I been born in any other place, I would have written in that in a language that comes naturally for me. Had I been born in Nigeria, which I'm not sure I would have enjoyed because of the many languages that are spoken there. So it's not a dilemma for me what language to choose, because there's one language that I'm more familiar with. There's one language in which I express myself, not necessarily in terms of writing, but in whatever deliberations that one has to enter into. It comes natural. But beyond the language, writing in a language per se, I regard writing in isiZulu as a contribution to my people, a contribution to my country,
yes.
a contribution to the literary landscape of our country. I doubt that I would have made any contribution had I written in English, because there wouldn't have been much to contribute. There are people who own the language who have contributed enough in English. So my contribution would have been a drop in the ocean. Mm-hmm. And maybe I suspect that people who own the language would have wondered why I worried myself about contributing to the language when it is not my language. So that's my take on why I write in isiZulu. I think it's where I'm needed most.
Can I just add something?
Absolutely, please.
I mean, you know, I just want to say something about how long I stayed in a predominantly Setswana-speaking community before I went to an urban area for the very first time in my life. I saw a traffic light for the very first time in my life when I went to university when I was 18 years old, you see. So 17 years of my life, that's 17 years of accumulating a language, that's a hell of a lot. That's massive archive.
It's interesting. And then if we were to project 20 years into the future, where do you locate your writing, specifically since you write in your mother tongue? What is the future of writing in your mother tongue in 20 years, particularly in a globalized context?
Well, it is difficult to answer that. I mean, it's difficult to give one answer to that question. One would, it would depend on what one means by the future of our writings. Essentially, my take on that is that there's still a lot that needs to be done. Unfortunately, some people think that writing in isiZulu is supposed to be easy. When you have failed everywhere else, then your last option would be to write isiZulu because it's a free for all and environment. That is what worries me most, the quality of our writings, the way we tell stories. For instance, if you take our short stories, for instance, that genre has been well developed. There are many writers who write short stories, but when you look, when you take a closer look at them, you will find that they're more or less the same in terms of the approach, in terms of the narrative style that I use. I'm not pessimistic, but I'm being realistic. There's a lot of work that still has to be done. But one is encouraged by the interest that writing in isiZulu has generated. There are many authors that you see, self-published authors, youngsters. Some of them have just been awarded. So the future looks bright in terms of numbers, in terms of interest. But then one has to consider other aspects as well, to specify and define what we mean by a bright future in our well. Kungasa emnyango masingaxoxa ngekusasa lihle kodwa futhi alihle kangaka ngoba esizulwini nokungebani nje ukuthola sekubhala kube sengathi umsangano izulu. So ke ngamemazi kufanele siboneke ukuthi sisho ukuthini ma sithi liqhakazile ikusasa kodwa futhi singabe sesithi kubi konke nje ngoba bakhona abantu ababhala izincwadi njengoba ngisho nje uma ubheka izindaba ezizimfushane kunezindaba ezimfushane ezisesingesini ezingasondele ngisho ukusondela ezindabeni ezimfushane esezibhala izinkondlo ngokwesibolo, our poetry. We have good poets, good poets, better than poets that we find in other languages. That translates as development and a rich heritage that we already have.
Do you think, Lamb, it's a limited scope of the narratives when you sort of look at it critically? We'll see there's still a lot of development that has to happen. Do you feel that there's not enough room to expand your imagination and talk about sort of
No, a lot extreme. Is a play. There are culprits who have ensured that our writings do not develop.
Okay, yes, all right. All right.
I mean, I'm very optimistic, you know. I mean, you want to know how I see the future in 20 years' time, and you talk about looking globally. I'm quite optimistic,
yes.
And I have to be realistic too. One, yes, I mean, the publishers are messing us up, but I think, you know, publishers are making money, and very soon they'll smell the coffee.
So want to be sure that there aren't any publishers in the house.
You know, no, it's fine safe, if they are here. It's fine if they are here because they need to hear.
They need to hear this.
Yeah. I mean, soon they will smell the coffee. Right. You know, I mean, how many people can read isiZulu? You know, it's over 10 million people. You see, how many people can read Setswana, Sesotho, and so on? There are millions of people. So will there be nobody who's going to read these books, who's going to buy these books? There will be people, you know. So publishers will smell the coffee and start publishing works in these languages. At the moment, when they do, they want to confine this to schools, which is a major problem because that does not mainstream African language literature. People write for schools. Personally, I don't want to do it because in the bigger picture, it does not serve the bigger purpose. You see, we're confined. It becomes a special category. There's a problem with that. See, I want somebody to say, it's a Saturday morning. What am I going to do with my weekend? I've got time. It's my last 250 rand. Okay? I'm taking it. I'm going to town. I'll buy 6-pack and I'll buy Sabata's novel. My weekend is sorted, right? Person must not say, if I don't buy it, I'll fail. It's forced. See?
It's a different kind of engagement. I don't become and motivation happy as an altogether. Author
because yeah. people are forced to buy my book.
Yes,
right.
Yes.
I'll say he went out of his way to buy
to
it.
Get it. Yeah.
See, that's what I'm talking about when I'm talking about mainstreaming it.
Yes. Right. Yes. Yes.
But another thing, then publishers, when it comes to when they publish African language literature, they cut corners so much. So they get your work. You've written in Setswana. They find somebody there. His name is Teboho, so it sounds like Setswana. His surname is Molefe, it's Setswana too. Teboho, can you proofread? Teboho comes from Deep Kloof. He left Soweto 12 years ago, he's been living in Durban. He proofreads. See?
Yeah.
The cutting corners, it's messing up the bigger picture. Yeah. Oh, so, but despite that, I'm hopeful. See? 3 weeks ago, I was in Washington, D.C. 2 days of the 3 weeks, I spent with Lesego Malepe. She's a retired South African professor living there. She just translated my young adult novella, Setswana novella, into English. See, that gives me hope.
Right.
And that means that I'm not under pressure anymore to write in English because if somebody says, no, I like the book and I'm going to translate it into English. So that gives me hope.
And
it tells me it can be accessed by people who cannot read Setswana.
Right. So if I may ask at this point, what happens when your work has to get translated? Can you maybe talk about, so I talk about the idea of writing as preservation of culture, preservation of heritage, preservation of identity, et cetera, through words. But what happens when you have to translate these non-tangible, mythical, spiritual aspects of our identity and of our beings to someone, say, who's based in Iceland or who's based in Denmark? You know, do you feel that your work kind of shifts character a bit and you sort of look at it from a different perspective as the writer?
I mean, you know, the first part of your question has got a loaded word, preservation, and there's culture and so on in that. And that gives me problems, you know, huge problems. I've got friends. Nick Mhlongo is my friend. He lives in Soweto. He writes in English. I don't overburden Nick with the preservation of the English culture. See, I write in Setswana. I don't think I have a responsibility to preserve Setswana culture. Setswana is my language, right? So the idioms, the proverbs, all these things that are in that language, I use them. I decided to write in Setswana. not because I want to preserve these things. See, this guy that I spoke about the other day called Saul Plaki, yes, who has said, made my life what it is, whether it got worse or better. But he said, one of the reasons he translated Shakespeare into Setswana was that he thought his language was under siege. That was about 100 years ago. Mm. He said, too many people are using English and Setswana and African languages will disappear. Mm. 100 years later, the language is here.
Yeah.
I mentioned numbers of people who speak the language, mm, and I said, more or less, there are 8 million people who speak Setswana in 4 Southern African countries. I come from the Northern Cape. There's a language there that is spoken by less than 10 people. See, government agencies are now in a panic mode, rushing to preserve that. Those are people who must be bothered with preservation.
Not you.
Not me. See? So, yes. So I'm not, so, but when it comes to translation, mm, let me say this, and this is what I said to Dr. Malepe. I said, and I call her Rakhadi. Rakhadi means aunt, but you know we have different aunts, friends. So I said to her, Rakhadi, you don't have to, because she's been sending me emails every week, seeing this phrase, and I understand because she left South Africa 39 years ago, mm-hmm, but she consumes Setswana literature more than people who are here. So she sends me emails every week, and we talk about her process, and I assist where I can. And then it came to a point where I said to her, but Rakhadi, you know, this book actually won 2 awards here in South Africa and is prescribed at 2 universities, right? Mm-hmm. That speaks to the quality of the book. If the translation is bad, it reflects on you, so I'm not really worried. So it's a complete process on its own. It reflects on the translator.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not really worried about it. I shouldn't be.
Right.
Maybe I should, but no, I'm relaxed.
At this point, you're not.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. My name is Anusbeya. You write short stories. You write poetry. Some of your stuff has gone to radio drama. Do you find that you're speaking to the same audience through these various mediums? Noma, are you speaking to more or less the same set of people? So are the people that you reach through your radio drama the same people who buy your short stories and the same people who are sitting in the audience when you're reciting in Gondl?
I assume that I'm speaking to the same audience, but I'm saying things differently. Sometimes I use drama, I use any format that would primarily suit my idea.
Sure.
There are ideas that can't fit well in a play, for instance, that are best told in the form of a novel. So the audience may be, generally speaking, the same. Mm. But food consumers, for instance, it, right, may be the same community, but one day they would like to have some meat, one day they would like to have a mass, like the coin. Even the ingredients, the way you are cooking, sometimes they would like something boiled or something. It's not that I'm too fond of food, but I'm making an example that anybody can understand. So the same goes for writing. But again, I regard myself as a person who has a responsibility, mm, to contribute across genres. There was a time that I got tired of writing short stories because I had written enough short stories and I was trying to avoid repeating myself. So I felt that I had made enough contribution in as far as short stories were. And that is when I ventured into writing radio dramas, for instance, so which may be regarded as a different audience, yeah, same audience, but the medium is different now. There was a time when people had read enough of my short stories, then I felt that my contribution is needed the most with regard to novels, for instance. That's when I started writing novels as a contribution and also as a personal development for myself, because one wouldn't like to be associated with one genre, because that that may seem like a malnutritioned writer who writes in anything. So as a writer, you reach a stage where you experiment with different genres, and one man mentioned that there's one audience that I have never considered in my writings, the school audience. I've never written particularly for school. I write for everybody. A story that my mother can enjoy. A story that my niece can enjoy. A story that does not confine and categorize people, that this is good for. That is my approach. Approach and guide me towards writing for a relevant audience.
And what are the tensions that you as writers are dealing with, specifically writing in your mother tongue, from an infrastructure point of view, support, financial support, publishing, etc., etc.? Sort of what are the greater lying challenges and tensions associated with? Your craft.
Publishing is the biggest of them all, you know. I have had quite a drama, you know, with my first novel. Mm. So I wrote this manuscript and sent it to a publishing company, a major one, a university press for that matter, and they liked it. After some 3-4 months, they wrote back to me, "No, we decided that we're going to publish this." Mm. I was so happy. It's my first work in my first mother tongue. It's going. I celebrated with a cup of rooibos.
Just rooibos?
Yeah, I mean, I'm boring, you know, so I don't drink other things. So we celebrated with my wife, you know. And then about a month later, somebody called me. This time, they did not send an email. This person called me and said, "You see, Sabata, you must understand that the money is in the schools." Then I knew that something stinking was coming, you know? He said, "The money is with the schools. So there are things here that I want us to talk about. Do you have time?" I said, "Yes." So I took out my notepad, said, "You see here, you have the corrupter and the corruptee. We suggest that you change the corrupter. You must make both of them Botswana, because your corrupter is Indian. And you are perpetuating the idea that Indians are skelems." I said, "Okay, your second one." Said, "You have a pedi, a gate man who is being discriminated against, is being insulted, and so on. We are not happy with that. Sorry, we want you to change that. And you say here you have a character who says men who belong to ZCC church are promiscuous. We don't like that." Okay. And other things, you see. And then I was quite angry, you know, because, I mean, in the Northwest, for goodness sake, in the Northwest, where do you find somebody who uses his own money, a black person who uses his own money to build townhouses and sell them? not somebody who gets a tender for RDPs. See, you don't get that, you see. And this Mopedi guy, he was important in the story because he was insulted on the basis of him being Mopedi. Nobody cared even to know his name. They just named him Matome because they know it's a common Pedi name. So that was so important there. All these things were so important. And I withdrew that, which was crazy because...
You did?
I did, you know. I did. Actually, I credit my wife more because she said, yeah, no, take it. Take it away. We'll see what we can do. And we found just one nice guy in Joburg who said, hey, my brother, I'll take it. I'll publish it.
Right.
You know. Right. So I felt that I was being driven to that school market. And I have absolute, I think it is important. People should write for that. But not me, you see?
Got you. I've got your burden again.
Yeah. I mean, if my friends can write what they like without being told, here's a framework, right within this framework because we're taking you to school. Why must I? Just because I write in a different language. See? That's the mainstreaming that I'm talking about. So write for everybody and throw it there among the wolves and see what happens to it. Whether there's money there or not, even if you're working somewhere, you're getting 5,000 a month, it's consolation. The book will see what happens.
Got you. So, top. The number.
Well, as a collective, I think we have serious problems, particularly with regard to getting published. It's a huge challenge. And in most cases, our writings are in wrong hands. You send your manuscript to a publisher who has a reviewer in the form of some university professor who has never written a sentence in their lives, and they take your book to this, who knows nothing about writing as a skill, who knows some theories that were created by somebody in Greece, for instance, some thousand years ago, and then they try to apply it. So, in short, getting published is a serious concern. Okay. And the fly by nights who are mushrooming around, and our people are getting ripped off in the process. They don't tell them the truth that, no, your writing is not yet ready for public consumption, and so forth. Yeah. So lots of challenges, but then we have to persevere. And
okay, so let's not be pessimistic about this. What are the advantages?
The advantages is, of course, money.
These are the prospects, okay.
Yeah, I'm serious about this. If you write good books, chances are you will make better money than some of us who write in English. For instance, you write a good novel, it gets published, it gets prescribed in books. Very few of us who write in English may get the chance. The numbers are in our favor. For instance, you write in isiZulu. How many people do isiZulu in high schools? How many do English? Well, or Afrikaans for that matter, or any other language. So there may be some financial benefits. The numbers are in our favor. The recognition. If I were to compare myself as a writer, how many people know me as a person against those who know those who write in this. So, kuningi engasangibona uma ngiqhathanisa, I'm I may be subjective about this, but it's reality. There are many a number of positives and benefit.
Okay. All right. You want a response to it very briefly?
Advantages? I'm called a writer. That's a massive advantage.
Right. Yeah, simple as that. Great. At this point, I'll take any questions, comments from the floor.
How do we define heart and soul in these sort of changing times? I'm asking that because in a capitalist society, especially in South Africa, you find that English is seen as a language, as the heart and soul of being part of the economy, of contributing to international literature and academics. I'm glad I saw my old professor when I was undergraduate right there, Prof. Tomaselli. It is the same thing in academia where you always have to publish in journals from Europe, in American journals, and you have to tell the narratives in the Euro-American perspective. And is it a similar thing in sort of writing novels, in this sort of changing heart and soul? And I like this concept of heart and soul because heart and soul always changes. And the very fact that we are conducting this in English is very telling. I once sat in class for 30 minutes in Tanzania at the University of Dar es Salaam, and the class was going on in Kiswahili. Until one nice student said, "Professor, he does not understand Swahili. He all speaks English." And he says, "Karibu mzee, karibu," and he continued in Swahili for a bit and put through a word of English there and there. But we are in a very sort of difficult times. So I would be very interested in understanding the heart and soul that we are talking about. And then another quick one, what is your feeling about this obsession of writing for an international audience in such a way that we start saying we want to write in English because we want to be acknowledged globally, instead of, I mean, if you look at writers, at people who wrote politically, Engel, Marx, they all wrote in German. Lefebvre, they all wrote in French, but we understand people quote Karl Marx, right? But Karl Marx wrote in German and never really cared about writing for a global audience, that I want people in Namibia to understand me in their language and in their local languages. So thank you.
My question has to do with them being creative writers in African languages, the different languages that I've mentioned, and also academics. So my question has to do with the other part of writing, which is critical writing. Like, we do see an improvement in the output, creative output, but what about the critical output?
Okay. Understood, thank you. So maybe Jens, you can respond to those two points.
No, let me respond to the last question because it's easier. Well, I unfortunately, for writers, particularly in isiZulu, and as the delegation of duties is very pathetic. For instance, you find that you are a writer and you still have a family, you still have a job. In some cases, you are in an academic environment, you still have to produce papers and do research as a contribution. So ours as writers is supposed to be confined to writing only. Because once you venture into the research part of it, it tends to temper with your primary obligation of writing. So I would say that there is a need for both, because it's very frustrating to do research when there is nothing to research on. You supervise a student, for instance, you battle to find relevant literature on those aspects. You are teaching some theories, say maybe realism or semiotics or whatever, and then you can't find enough examples because there are fewer writers who have write along the lines that will suit suit your theoretical interpretation. So there should be enough writers so that those who want to do research may find enough text to work. So that in most cases, for instance, you take drama, for instance. In most cases, there are very few plays, and then that's why we end up focusing more on Shakespeare as appropriate examples of how drama is supposed to look like.
Okay. Yeah.
Very brief. The facility just told me we have very little time.
Yes.
Brother Nkosinathi, creative writing academics should produce creative writing, and it should carry the same weight as academic articles and so on. In fact, at our university, we're still having the debate, it's still ongoing. But I feel that it is unfair for me to be expected to to produce as much academic articles as my other colleagues, whose primary output is that, while I'm expected to write novels and short stories as well. When you go to the US, for instance, and statistics will tell you, MFA programs, when they are competing for students, they put books of faculty members there, and they say, these are the books of people who are going to teach you creative writing. So it is so important. I won't take a lot of time. Writing for international audience, my brother, I'm writing for international audience in Setswana. You cool. See, it's a Southern African language. It's not South African language.
Okay.
And right. For me, people who speak Setswana in Namibia and Zimbabwe and Botswana, that's international.
Okay.
And it's international, it's not in America and so on. But I think that translation will make it possible as well.
Mfonokubuzala, about the market of the, let's say you're writing in Zulu. I'm asking in the aspects of the government, what can a government do to stimulate and make sure that the markets for these writers of the language that you want to use are there. Because it's different from someone who has studied for art and culture and got a degree, and it different, the ideas are different from someone who is an artist who knows what they are talking about. So what the government can do in terms of the strategies on making sure that these stories reach the people, Ekmele Ifeakbon. Because the people who are supposed to read these stories, now they are not here.
Okay. Siyabonga Mfowethu.
And I'll take that last one, please.
What inspired you guys to be writers?
I don't think the government is supposed to do anything to encourage people to read books. It should come naturally. Because when you grew up listening to your grandmother's stories, was there a government there which said, listen to my story? So it should come. The government has enough problems, and it's failing to solve a lot of such problems. Let us read. Let us not wait for somebody to tell us. Then that will create a market for us. The government will not do enough or okay. Anything. It's about okufanele bafunde izincwadi zabo ngezilimi zabo hayi nangezilimi zabo kuphela nangesingisi nangezinye izilimi bangalindeli ukuba bangalindeli uhulumeni ukuthi ngoba yikho lokho okubanga izinkinga eziningi ukuthi abantu bahlale bethi uhulumeni nezinto abangazenzela bona njengokufunda nje.
And what inspired you to be a writer?
A lot. I come from a writing family, particularly on my maternal side. So I grew up in that, and I knew that one doesn't have to die first so that they can be regarded as writers. The environment, the immediate environment, the stories in the community, how events unfolded and were portrayed later in the form of this, that inspired me. But the most inspiration was from reading books. I read like my head was crazier than it already was. But I read, so that inspired me to be a writer.
Yes, brother.
We can take other questions if there's time.
I can't take more questions, so I can only just respond to these two and we're done.
Sure. I mean, I'm really not expecting much from the government anymore. They've got SASA issues to deal with now, you know. So let's get them out of this thing. We've got roles to play, and let's take those roles very seriously. Inspired by stories, I've got stories to tell, and I believe it's worth the trouble, you know. So that is why I'm writing, and so I'm inspired by people who told me stories, and they believe that I can tell stories, and the few people who bought my books inspired me to write more. So that's where the inspiration is continuously coming from.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, gentlemen. Siyabonga kakhulu, and thank you too, as the audience. You've been a very good audience. That, thank you.
We owe somebody an answer. We'll answer it.
Yeah, we can answer it at intermission. So thanks very much, and I hope you stick around for the next session. Siyabonga. Mm-hmm.